and a common heritage. And as Dr. Deborah said, the European or Western powers dismembered the Arab world in World War II. By the way, before I get any farther, all Arab nations have condemned the invasion of Kuwait. There is not one Arab nation that did not condemn the invasion. They were all against it. Unfortunately, neither President Bush nor Mubarak nor King Fahd allowed the Arab League to do its job and bring about a solution. The problem in the Middle East today is viewed from an Arabic point of view as two brothers that are fighting each other. It is a family view. So therefore, it should be solved by the members of that specific family. And it, we don't need anybody to come from outside and impose on us their own solutions, mainly with a gun. We believe Iraq is a part of the Arab world. Saddam Hussein injured the Arab world. And the United States is digging deeper in that injury. We would like to see Saddam Hussein probably taught a small lesson politically, economically, or otherwise, but not militarily. We do not stand for the dismemberment of Iraq from the Arab body politics or from the Arab nation. Iraq is part of the Arab world, and it should remain so.
Arab
attempts to think of the United States not as leading any popular international coalition, but as an imperialist power running guard for Israel, its supposed client state in the area. This sickens me, but I must admit it's shrewd, Machiavellian, and given his desperate situation, I suppose a tactic that ought not to be surprising. But what concerns me most is that it just may work. For Iraq to suggest that somehow his conquest of Kuwait is tied to the Palestinian question is absurd. The idea of a linkage is offensive on both intellectual and political grounds. It is a brazen attempt to split a coalition that includes Arab partners, just as the invasion of Kuwait was a brazen violation of the sovereignty of a legitimate Arab state. Most Arab states have not fallen for Saddam's ridiculous propaganda. Egypt and even Syria have so far rejected such linkage. But sadly, and perhaps tragically, for those who supported a moderate, independent, peaceful Palestinian state, the PLO has bought into Baghdad's line, and Yasser Arafat has become a supporter of Saddam Hussein. In its support for the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait, the PLO has made a terrible mistake. On January 7th, Yasser Arafat warned that if it came to war, Iraq and Palestine would be, quote, together, side by side. But such a position undermines the movement towards a two-state solution, the only kind of political solution that can lead to peace between Israelis and Arab Palestinians, in my opinion. Let me quote Walid Khalidi, a Palestinian intellectual. The principles violated by Saddam in his invasion of Kuwait were the very principles from which the Palestinian cause drew its moral strength. The terrorist image that Arafat was so desperate to shed was only reconfirmed by a close association with Saddam after his invasion of Kuwait. Khalidi goes on after that to say, quote, the PLO's failure to come out publicly, repeatedly, and forcefully against the invasion of Kuwait and in favor of Iraqi withdrawal in accordance with the UN resolutions has gravely damaged its political credibility and its international standing, unquote. Now, one might think that I, as an American Jew and a lover of the State of Israel, would be pleased at the PLO's demise, but far from it, I am deeply saddened by it. Saddened because I think we are much further from peace than before. A weakened PLO will mean a more radical PLO, a PLO that is manipulated by states like Iraq and Syria. That, I am afraid, will get us nowhere. Certainly the impact of recent Palestinian support for Hussein has been devastating for the left-wing dovish politics of the Israeli Labor Party, the loyal opposition, and more specifically for those courageous Israeli statesmen such as Abba Ibn, with whom I most identify. The Israeli left, of course, a minority of Israeli public opinion at this point, as well as in the few years preceding this conflict. The Israeli left was willing to trade land for peace. It was willing to face the PLO in direct negotiations. It was even willing to enter into an international conference on the Middle East. In other words, it was prepared for a comprehensive settlement that would involve painful concessions and compromises. But no longer. The reaction of the Palestinians before the war, but especially since the launching of the Scud missiles, has played into the hands of the most right-wing recruited ministers. For years, Prime Minister Shamir has been telling us that Arabs cannot be trusted. The Likud has insisted that Palestinian Arabs would only use the two-state solution, that is, the creation of an independent Palestinian state on the West Bank and Gaza, to wage war on Israel. And even if Palestinians wanted peace, such a state would be manipulated by Iraqi, Syrians, and others who would not. For months before August 2, 1990, the loyal opposition in Israel and many American Jews, including myself, shouted, no, you must give peace a chance. Well, what has happened in recent days has completely undermined our position. You see, the Israelis will never allow a Palestinian state unless Israel can be sure that its borders are secure. And that brings me to the launching of the Scud missiles against innocent civilian Jews and Arabs in Tel Aviv and other major urban centers. From the moment one of those missiles got through, a new and horrifying epoch began. From the founding of the State of Israel in 1948 until the Six-Day War in 1967, shots and short-range missiles were routinely fired upon small border settlements. But after 67, and particularly after 70 and 73, Israel enjoyed relatively secure borders. But now Iraq has shown that it can terrorize Israel whenever it wishes. And there is no doubt that it wishes to do just that. No country can tolerate that kind of insecurity. Even the most pacifist among us must recognize Israel's right, indeed its obligation, to defend its civilian population. said earlier that Israel has no business in a war to restore a Kuwaiti regime, but it certainly does have a very high stake in that war by shooting Scud missiles toward Israel's large urban centers. Saddam Hussein is acting on his long-held goal of destroying Israel. Those of us on the left didn't think he'd really mean it, or we didn't think he'd really do it, or we didn't think West Bank and Gaza Palestinians would really support him doing it. Well, we were very wrong. Perhaps the United States and the international coalition can stick to its avowed aim of liberating Kuwait and leaving Saddam Hussein's regime intact. But Israel can no longer afford that. Israel's viewpoint, once the first Scud landed on Israeli soil, it meant that Saddam Hussein had to be overthrown. If the American-led alliance can't or won't do it now, I am afraid that Israel will have to do it later. Finally, there is a way, and an important one, that the fate of Kuwait and the fate of Israel are actually tied together. Years ago, Woodrow Wilson had a dream that the resolution of certain international conflicts would come about through new international agencies that would ensure collective security for big as well as small states. Of course, he was thinking primarily of Europe, but there was that dream that inspired the League of Nations and then the United Nations. Americans after the First World War wanted no part of Wilson's internationalism, and you know it came next, a Second World War. But after that, although Americans were willing to shoulder such obligations, the Cold War made a mockery of collective security. But now, as President Bush recognizes, there is a window of opportunity, however small, for collective security to be put back on the table. Only through a system of collective security that ensures the security of states like Kuwait and Israel will Palestinians realize their dream of a peaceful, secure, and moderate, stable state. Thank you.
Compliment the panelists. You've done very well, sticking to the time. Now this is your opportunity. We suggest again, as I did before, there clearly are several formats we can use. Questions and statements. Statements. I would suggest we try statements, but I also reserve the right if somebody begins